Events tonight. I just want to share a thought, and pray that the Lord will minister to us. In Luke chapter number five. And I want to start reading verse number 12. The Bible says, and it came to pass, when he was in a certain city, behold, a man full of leprosy, who seeing Jesus fell on his face and besought him, saying, Lord, if thou wilt, thou canst make me clean. And he put forth his hand and he touched him, saying, I will, be thou clean. And immediately the leprosy departed from him. And he charged him to tell no man, but to go and to show thyself to the priest, and offer for thy common cleansing according as Moses commanded for a testimony unto them. But so much more went there a fame abroad of him, and great multitudes came together to hear, and to be healed by him of their infirmities. I really, toward the end of my message, want to focus on this verse number 16. And he withdrew himself into the wilderness and prayed. And he withdrew himself into the wilderness and prayed. I want to ask you this question. Really, it comes from W.A. Tozer, or A.W. Tozer, his book, The Knowledge of the Holy. And he asks this question, what comes to our mind when we think about God? What do we think about Him? What is the most important thing to us? When we think about God, do we look at God as if we look at just a black velvet sky at night and diamonds, Brother David, thrown out on that velvet? Do we look up in the universe and realize that we have a God who is greater than this universe round about us? I mean, do we look at God in that way that we trust Him and we see Him as being big? Or do we bring God down to this localized level that He's big as lichens, or He's as big as, Pennsylvania? We limit His size. I hope tonight that when we look at God, that we look at Him being bigger than life itself, and that He is bigger than any problem that you and I could ever come in contact with. He's just huge. And if we see God as being that big God in whom He is, first of all, we will pray before we act. Amen. But if we bring Him down on a localized level and we make Him small, we will act before we pray. Amen. And it's really tonight about seeing God. Seeing God as being so very, very big. Amen. Imagine this. I want to ask you, do you see God as just being religious? You know, we think about that religious part of our life. Every one of us are religious or spiritual, particularly because we are at church. Amen. There may be others that call themselves religious or spiritual who don't attend a church. And, you know, I scratch my head at that sometimes, just to be honest. But there are folks who are religious. Amen. But that's the problem. They're just religious. It doesn't come to a place that we see God outside of religion. He's just kind of stuck in that compartment of religion when our minds have so many other compartments. But tonight we need to be challenged to see God who is big enough to be bigger than religion or bigger than any certain compartment. But God is big.
Amen.
Amen. God is big. And God is able tonight. Amen. So when we look at Him as being big, He's the Creator, and that He covers everything. Amen. This Jesus Christ, He wants intimacy with us.
Amen.
Amen. This big, big God. And He wants intimacy with us.
Amen.
And I look at Him and I see that Jesus Christ, this deity of who He was. I love this. The Bible says that it came to pass when He was in a certain city, behold, a man full of leprosy, seeing Jesus, fell on his face. Amen. Let's just stop there for a few moments. Here it is that this man, the Bible says that he was full of leprosy. Now, they say that there are two types of leprosy, Brother Craig. One that will affect the skin in a small patch. Maybe it would be like a red mark, maybe it would be a white mark. However, that I think more white in its nature. Maybe you saw someone with psoriasis and you understand, you know, that white mark being there, symbolizing leprosy. Now, I know they're completely different. I'm just simply using that as an illustration tonight. But then, Brother Doug, there is a leprosy that actually ate at the body and the flesh and would deteriorate that and eat away at that. And so we are told that this is the type of leprosy that this man had, that he had this leprosy that was eating away at him. Can you imagine meeting up with someone and you see that their body is being eaten away? I mean, you see their tendons, you see the muscle part of them, maybe you even see the bone of them, you see the fighting of their body against this, and it stinks. And so there is that social stigma that comes with that. And now they've been cast outside the city. And so the social stigma, the leprosy that is intensified, you literally see death's tentacles wrapped around this person, because that's what they are doing. They are dying. I'll never forget the first time me as a young man, I was working with Brother Luther Travis. He passed away at Assembly of God Church in West Virginia. And I'm telling you, that man traveled everywhere, visiting everyone. He had a stroke, and so the summer before I came to Lycans, I worked with him, and I absolutely loved it. I was somewhat hesitant the first to work, but he asked me if I would be a chauffeur, if I would preach certain services for him. And I learned so much that summer, Brother David. As I was there, he took me into a hospital where there was a young man in his late 20s, and it was the first time I ever saw someone that was so jaundiced, and they had the lights dim, and he was literally dying. And as I looked at him, I saw death. I remember how that grabbed my heart, and how it tugged at me, and how it changed me. And so here it is. Can you imagine? Here is this leprous man. He is dying. And the tentacles of death is around about him. People look at him and see death upon him. They smell him. They see the social stigma of all that. And can you imagine that probably there are times where there's mothers that have their children, and as that guy goes by, they cover the eyes of their children because they don't want their children to see the sight of this man. And there he is. Everyone's keeping a distance. Even doctors of that day probably walking by and shaking their head because they don't know the remedy or the cure for this one. It puzzles them. So this is the situation with this man. No one dared to step real close to him because they saw him as being an open grave. So here it was that the leper, he saw Jesus and he knew that this man held life in his hands. And so he came to Jesus, and I love how this was. And I know I'm getting to the end, but I can't slip over some of this stuff. And I want to focus on this end verse, but let's get there for a moment. The Bible says that he fell on his face and he besought him, saying, Lord, if thou wilt, thou canst make me clean. He doesn't come bargaining. He doesn't come with no expectation. He just comes with this giant amount of faith that God is able to make him whole. Hey, here I am. I'm an open grave. Here I am. I'm dying. Here I am, the guy that the moms cover their eyes, the eyes of their children. Here I am, this guy that has a social stigmatism. Here I am. I'm the one that sees and feels my body, hate what's happening inside of me. But I know that God is able to make me whole. I'm talking about faith tonight. Amen. This guy has amazing faith. And he throws himself in worship at the feet of Jesus. And he says, no exceptions, no bargaining. I know you're able to make me whole. Let me ask you, man. Is that how you see God tonight? That God is able to do anything, regardless of what your situation appears and is. Amen. That God is able to do anything. You don't have to bargain with them. You just come with an expectation and faith that God, you are able. So here it is that the Bible says that Jesus, he saw him. And this is what I love. Look at verse number 13 with me. Look at this verse. And he put forth his hand and touched him. Wow! And he put forth his hand and he touched him. Do you see what Jesus did? The one that was untouchable, the one no one else wanted to get around. Amen. The Bible says that Jesus reached out and touched him. How long had it been since he felt the touch of another individual? How long has it been since he felt compassion and love and the warmthness? We are designed for touch. Amen. But he hadn't been touched. But Jesus reached out and he touched him. This is interesting. My mom told me she went to the doctor and she didn't know what was going on in her face. And guess what? There was only one provider in and she was pregnant. You know what that meant? That you don't come visit the lady that might have shingles. And so from another room, her assistant had to come and take pictures and ask questions and run back and forth from room to room because there was no way that she was going to put herself or her baby in harm's way. And no fault finding. She did what was right. But could you imagine expecting a provider? Maybe they could just say, I know what you may have. I'll call you in a prescription. Amen. But the great physician here, amen, didn't keep this man at arm's length. Amen. But Jesus came to touch the untouchables. Amen. You hear me? Jesus came to touch the untouchables. How awesome is that tonight? That our God will touch the very untouchables. That is who He is. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. He came to with the Father's cup of love. Amen. To allow people who are parched to have a drink of that cup of love from the Father. That's who He is. Amen. That's the God that we serve. That's how big He is. That's how compassionate He is. That's how much He loves tonight. Hallelujah. Amen. The Bible says, and immediately the leprosy departed from. Immediately, God is able to do it. Immediately. Praise God. The story went on that he was to go and show himself to the priest. Do what Moses said. Follow the protocol. Don't mention me. You know why, Brother Doug? Because he wasn't there promoting himself. Brother Justin, he was there promoting the Father. And so, the Bible says that there was even greater multitudes that came and wanted to help him along. The Bible says this, and he withdrew himself into the wilderness. This is where I want us to spend a few moments before we come to prayer. Brother Craig, he withdrew himself into the wilderness. See, because this man, the Son of God, he relied solely upon his Father. He needed a place of prayer. You turn back just to the previous chapter, and you'll read that Jesus picks up the scripture and he begins to read from Isaiah, and he talks about how that the Spirit of the Lord was upon him and anointed him. Amen. And he realized he needed the Father. He needed an anointing from the Holy Ghost. And Brother Eli, he was amen, the Son of God. And he's the one that has authority over the Spirit, the Holy Ghost. But he realized his need for the Spirit of God in his life. When you look at Jesus in Luke 16, he goes to the mountain to pray. And Mark chapter number 1, the Bible says, while it was still dark, he left the house and he went to a solitary place and prayed. Mark 6:46, he went to a place and prayed. You look at him being baptized, Brother Doug, and for the first time this week, I really realized, Sister Rachel, of the Scripture, when he was baptized, the Bible says that there he was praying, and the Spirit of God descended like a dove. Amen. He was praying. Amen. And if Jesus needed a place of prayer, how much more do you and I need a place of prayer? Amen. That we can share the love of God with others, that those who are parched by the things of this world may have a drink of the Father's love. You want to show love and compassion the way that Christ showed love and compassion, you will only be in a place of prayer. Prayer was a priority action for him.
Amen.
There was a relationship that Jesus had with the Father. By the day after his baptism, he went away to the wilderness for 40 days of prayer and fasting. It was there that the enemy tempted him 3 times, Sister Beth. All 3 times he overcame. You know why? Because he was in a place of prayer with the Father. Can I tell you that if he would have fallen, Sister God, to the temptation of the enemy, there would never have been a place called Calvary. There would never have been an old rugged cross. There would never have been a world that would know redemption. But because he had a relationship with his Father in prayer, amen, he overcame temptation and he did the Father's will. How do you and I know what the will of God is for our life? How do we do the will of God? Let me tell you, it's by entering into a place of prayer. Amen. And having a closeness with God Almighty. The Word of God says, pray that you enter not into temptation. Amen. The Word of God tells us that our enemy is like a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. What's our necessary element to have someone who's greater than the lion? Amen. You think the lion roars louder? Look at the God of this universe. When we develop a relationship with him in prayer, we'll understand that he's the great lion slayer. Amen. He can tame the lions and shut their mouth. Just ask Daniel. Why did he have faith in the lions? Did? Because he had a place of prayer.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Tonight it's about a place of prayer. Amen. Where we move God from a localized level to a level that's beyond this universe, that he is able to do exceedingly and abundantly above all that we can ask. God's greater than the diagnosis. God's greater than financial pressures. Amen. But it all starts with a place of prayer. Brother David, you said something when you were sharing tonight. We're talking about your furnace. We're talking about your vehicle. I'll call that Life 101. Maybe it's more to you than that. But all you need to do is have a Life 101 and you realize that life is not a picnic. Anyone realize that? But understanding a relationship with the Savior on a regular basis takes us from a localized God. Takes us from being religious to allowing God in every compartment of our life, and he's bigger and he is greater. Mr. Holly, if you come to the piano tonight. This evening, I just feel impressed to say this. We are that leprous man. We are the untouchable. Why should he? Why would he? We don't even have anything better correct than bargain with him with. Because we don't really have any commodities that he doesn't already have over and over again and greater than. So with all bargaining aside, we just need God to touch us. We were designed to be touched by God. And when he touches us,
our testimony will be shed abroad. Mm-hmm. What makes a difference in our workplace and your workplace when we don't keep God in a religious spot, but when we allow Him to be big in everything? I don't want to haphazardly or flippantly think that people don't have needs, but I don't want to be able to, Brother David, look them square in the eye and be matter of fact. God can touch you and God can change it. Brother Eli, what makes a difference for you in a laundromat with people that you're able to touch that I'll never be able to see is because you spend time with God and you show them that God is bigger than the universe. Sister Tina, I know that you're not on the platform of sharing the gospel all day, but you know, it's who you are, it's what you do. So when they come in with things that are bigger, we've been serving God that's bigger than this universe, so we can express to them that God has touched me, and He's big. He's able to touch you. Brother Doug, guys that are behind bars, maybe rightfully so, maybe unjustly so, I don't know. But you're able to say, but God is bigger. Brother Craig, some young pups at your workplace, they see this other mechanic there that has faith in God for him and for his family. Because we release God to be bigger than a localized level. He's a God of this universe. Up there on the mountain, Brother Wallace, for Bev, for Dot, a whole community that you're able to show God is bigger than. Brother Justin, they might come from a place that there's no better savings, but they find a resource where there's no better, no bigger than God. Because one guy back in the automotive section exhibited that to them. I'm talking about us needing communion with God. If Jesus needed it, how much more do we need it? Amen. He still prays to the Father. Amen. So how much more do you and I need to pray to the Father? Let's gather in and get our scope of God on a bigger level than it's ever been before. Amen. Gather in and pray tonight.